The third way to tell if a Native American is a European. If a Native American tells you that the Redskin logo is racist, then he probably is a European. What do you mean by that, Rick?
Well, I'm sure everybody's heard, you know, about what's going on with the Redskins and the so-called Europe. They're European tribes, you know, complain about the logo. But the problem that they have with the logo is they have a problem with the face, because the face looks just like us. And they can't stand it. If you look at the television and you see the ones complaining, all of them are European, all of them. And they just whining and crying and everything about that logo. And they all, and not just the Redskins, you know, the Indians and the Braves, and, you know, they're crying about all this stuff, but it don't even refer to them.
But, Rick, what I want to know is this. This is what gets me. The so-called African American sees these images are right in front of our face, and we don't even recognize that it's us. How is that possible?
When you erase the people, when you change.
If a Native American doesn't blend into the environment in the forest of America, then he's probably a European. What you mean by that, Rick Moon?
What I mean by that is, and we've had shows on this, that all indigenous people belong to a landmass somewhere on this earth. And they fit the environment of that landmass. If you take your average, your so-called Native American, and put him in the natural environment in America, which is the forest, he will stick out like a sore thumb.
Now, Rick, give us an example of that.
Example. Let's look at it the other way. As far as our people go, you can go to the forest, and all you have to do is just take another person with you. Take your brother, your sister, or your best friend, as long as they're one of your people, and look at each other reflection in that forest, and you will notice how you blend in with all the trees, with all the sand, the rocks, the whole layout. You blend perfectly in. As a matter of fact, when the European got over here, that was one of the problems he had when he came over here, because he had a hard time distinguishing us from the environment. All you have to do is just take one of your people with you. All these so-called, and I'm talking about the so-called African Americans, because the real Aborigines or indigenous Americans know this, what I'm talking about.
Message!
America, and were published in the late 1700s. Who are the children in these images? Who are the people going into the waterfall behind them? Are we to believe that these children came to America on so-called slave ships? Do they look like slaves? Who are the children in these images? Who are the children in these images? Who are the children in these images? Who are the people going into the waterfall behind them? People going into the waterfall behind them. Are we to believe that these children came to America on so-called slave ships? People going into the waterfall behind them. Are we to believe that these children came to America on so-called slave ships? People going into the waterfall behind them. Are we to believe that these children came to America on so-called slave ships?
Civilizations here in America, man.
we had whole civilizations. The East Coast was inhabited by, you know, one type of native close to the, you know, the Iroquois and what have you. The Midwest area was inhabited by a mixture of, you know, black indigenous people, Mongoloid indigenous people, but the Southeast was almost exclusively inhabited by black indigenous people. And at one time, there was even a distant outpost of the Aztec culture in the Southeastern United States, and they traded with the Aztecs that were in Mexico. Matter of fact, go Google a picture of the last two full-blooded Aztecs and tell me what you find. You go see two people that you know are black. Go Google it. In 1515, when Hernan Cortez got here, you know, there were another group of natives, Mongoloid natives, that had got sick of centuries of domination at the hands of the Aztecs that were black. And so when they saw these white men coming on the shore, they gladly ushered them up to the gates of Tenochtitlan. They did it gladly so they can get these black dudes off their damn neck. You know, it is what it is. They made a strategic decision or whatever. They opened the door for the white man, but hey, look where it's got the world now.
Those Arawak Indians never existed here. In fact, the only people that we can prove existed here in this region are the so-called Caribs. And guess what? The Caribs are not medium-billed, copper-colored people. They are black. If anyone's ever been to Trinidad or St. Vincent or St. Lucia or St. Kitts, where these Caribs supposedly were, you'll see that the people that call themselves Caribs are black. They do have some of them curly hair, straight hair.
Son, Paul, I'm too hard there for set things straight. And I did not tell the man for put them feet. Get them, set them down and wait. No debate. You up now? Check it. Well, woman, no one obeyed. Them not go feel violate. If you accelerate, pan a day, them all you infiltrate. Woman, them all you tear down them wall and them gate. In the year, what mistake? Woman, no one obeyed. Them not go feel violate.
Message!
Them not gonna feel violate if you accelerate. When I dead, them all you infiltrate. Woman, them why you tear down them wall and them gates in the year. Well, woman, I wanna coat from an boot where you are. You fit tell that for tear off your suit. Them not wanna do it whenever you know the mood and them no one. A little boy with no girl attitude. Well, I know nothing for we either. You know the girl, them pathway, man, a slide and a glide. It's a natural thing for we collider. Be doom argument like for divider. Get you ride. Woman, no wanna bait. Them not gonna feel violate if you accelerate. Wanna date, the more you infiltrate. Woman, the more you tear down them wall and them gates. In the year, what we say, the man no wanna bait. Them not gonna feel violate if you accelerate. Wanna
something which has never been mentioned in the archaeology for some odd reason. And that is, at the back of the stone head, there was hair. Detailed Ethiopian type hair. No Native American has hair like that. Detailed Ethiopian type hair. No Native American has hair like that. Detailed Ethiopian type hair. No Native American has hair like that. Detailed Ethiopian type hair. No Native American has hair like that.
Another black group, a pre-Columbian black group in the Americas, mostly along the West Coast, California, what is now Acapulco, of a black group of people who do not trace their ancestry to Africa. No one can understand where these people have come from. None of them survive anymore. They do not exist. They have been either bred out of existence or they were the victims of disease or whatever. However, with this new DNA testing, which is now, in other words, all the DNA of every group in the world is now fed into a computer. A computer then can make correspondences, comparisons between every other group. This black group, which they found traces of in the Americas matches, strangely enough, with Micronesia on the other side of the Pacific to a people called the Negritos. These are black people who trace their origins not east from Africa, but westwards across the Pacific. Now that leaves a tremendous problem. How is it possible that these Negritos or their ancestors could have possibly come across the vast expanse of the Pacific?
If you didn't walk back, we'll stay far. We're dealing with tunes and rhymes. Come some more into my side.
Oldest Homo sapiens ever found on this land are from Brazil. The name that the archaeologists and anthropologists gave to the skeleton is Lucia, L-U-C-I-A, all right? Dr. Richard Neave of the University of Manchester did craniological studies on this entity and did a reproduction of the model of what Lucia would look like, and based on craniological studies, which is phenotype, he declared that she was anthropologically Negro. Period. I'm not even going to some of the other things that we could quote and highlight. I did that lecture on Sign of the TV when I did Indigenous Science versus Evolution. But my question to Henry Louis Gates is this: if you're going to measure the DNA of Native Americans, why don't you go get a sample from Lucia and get family tree DNA to get their archaeogenomic scientists to use that set of DNA to measure it up against all the people that you tested? Morgan Freeman, all right? Oprah, all these people that you tested. Take her set of genes and match it up against them. You are taking the Austronesian DNA of these pale groups, measuring it against ours and telling us we're not Native American. That was a part of the plot from the beginning. This is from the Temple of Warriors in Chichen Itza. It cost me $600 to get this book. Why did it cost me $600 to get this book and they had to take it from the Smithsonian vault? This is showing a race of people in Mexico, all right, who are arresting the people who call themselves natives today. They put a special paint on these people so that they could recognize them. And these bars on their bodies and paint gave rise to the symbolism of a prisoner wearing bars, the barred uniform. So these people who are pale are calling themselves Mayans. And these right here are the Olmec Mayans or the Xi. All right. And so our identity here has been stolen. There was no slave trade yet in Chichen Itza when these were being made. Slavery came thousands of years later. How did these black people get here? How did they get here?
You had all that Western Horn of Africa that was popping to the point where Kankan Musa and Abu Bakari set up a system that basically bankrupted all of the old dynasties that existed in so-called Africa, and then set up the expeditions that the Malian Empire would then extend further into the western portion of Mali, which they now call a Mexico. Mm-hmm. So between 1321 and 1511, you had the rise and influx of all of these other Moors that were coming here also to combat the Spanish annexation of all of the colonies, that Moorish cities and colonies that they was trying to take over.
Timbuktu had long been a destination or stop for merchants from the Middle East and North Africa. It wasn't long before ideas as well as merchandise began passing through the fabled city. Since most, if not all, these traders were Muslim, the mosque would see visitors constantly. The temple accumulated a wealth of books from throughout the Muslim world, becoming not only a center of worship, but a center of learning. Books became more valuable than any other commodity in the city, and private libraries sprouted up in the homes of local scholars. In addition to books, Timbuktu accumulated navigational maps and logs from geographers throughout the world. During the 10th century, stories began to surface of sailors reaching a distant land. One of the first accounts came from a 10th century historian named Ali al-Masudi. An accomplished geographer, philosopher, and natural scientist, he wrote a book called In the Meadows of Gold and Quarries of Jewels. In it, he tells the story of a young man from Spain named Kashkash ibn Said, who crossed the Atlantic Ocean, made contact with people on the other side, and returned in the year 889 AD. Al-Masudi wrote, "Kashkash gathered a group of young men and went on a voyage on this ocean. He returned with a fabulous booty. Every Spaniard knew his story." By the 12th century, the world's best-known geographer, Muhammad Ali Drisi, was also telling stories of sailors crossing the Atlantic. Al-Idrisi had created the most accurate map of the world in pre-modern time. His book, The Delight of Him Who Desires to Journey Through the Climates, is a geographical encyclopedia containing detailed maps and information on European countries, Africa, and Asia. Book of Roger, which was drawn by Al-Idrisi in 1154 for King Roger II of Sicily, contained legends written in Arabic and was copied by geographers for three centuries without alteration. In his book, Al-Idrisi told stories of a Moorish ship which had crossed the Atlantic around 800 AD. He added validity to the reports recorded by other Muslim historians and geographers concerning Muslim seamen and navigators crossing the Atlantic Ocean. He also wrote about Portuguese seamen who crossed the Great Sea. A group of sailors traveled into the Sea of Darkness from Lisbon in order to discover what was in it and to what extent were its limits. They finally reached an island that had people who spoke Arabic. This astonishing historical report not only describes contact between Muslim seamen and the native people of the Americas, but suggests a strong familiarity between the two. By the 14th century, West Africa had seen the rise of the Mali Empire, one of the largest in the world during that time. The king of Mali was Mansa Abu Bakari, who was the nephew of the empire's founder, Sundiata Keita. As a young man, Abu Bakari heard stories of a land across the Atlantic and dreamed of sailing off into the massive ocean. While studying at Sankore University, Abu Bakari encountered maps from Muslim geographers such as Al-Masudi and Ali Drisi, who had concluded that the Atlantic Ocean was not the western edge of the world. He learned about ocean currents, studied navigational charts, and also heard amazing tales of Sudanese people who had ventured across the Atlantic some 2,000 years earlier. Abu Bakari had been assured by learned professors and Arab geographers that new lands lay on the other side of the Great Green Ocean. Sometime around 1304, Abu Bakari assembled a fleet of ships and sent them west across the Atlantic in search of the new land. Accounts of the expedition are documented in a book by 14th century Arab historian Al-Umari. According to his writings, Mansa Abu Bakari launched 200 ships filled with men and a further 200 ships amply stocked with food, gold, and water to last for 2 years. African griots, who are known as the oral historians of African civilization, tell the story of one of those ships returning and informing Abu Bakari of their journey. The captain told him of their success in reaching a beautiful new land. Upon the news, the African ruler would gather a fleet of 2,000 ships, which he would lead himself. Ready were his best sailors, farmers, and carpenters, and in the year 1311, he would hand over the government and the title of Mansa to his brother Kankan Musa and fulfill his lifelong dream to sail across the Atlantic.
People from what was then the Mali Empire took off. It's almost certain they took off. The big debate is whether they arrived in the Americas.
In the year 1405, China's Ming Emperor had assembled the greatest fleet the world had ever seen. With more than 300 junks, some of them the biggest wooden ships ever built, and a combined crew of 28,000, the mighty Starfleet was to embark on 7 epic voyages. The historical record shows that under the supreme command of a Muslim eunuch called Zheng He, the fleet expanded China's known world to Malacca, Sumatra, Java, Sri Lanka, India, Arabia, Africa, perhaps even Australia. But after 30 years of extraordinary achievement, there was a dramatic reversal of policy. Jealous Confucian courtiers forced the empire to abandon its forward naval policy. Zheng He was forgotten, his fleet laid up, and many of his maps, logs, and records destroyed. This historical vacuum has fueled ideas that there might be a missing chapter in the story of the Ming fleet. Gavin Menzies, a former submarine commander of Britain's Royal Navy, has spent 15 years poring over maps and documents of the period. Now, in a theory that defies academic opinion, he claims that on its sixth voyage, Zheng He's fleet sailed beyond its home waters to cross the Atlantic Ocean. If he's correct, the Chinese could have discovered the Americas 70 years before Christopher Columbus.
When the first European explorers set forth for the New World, every single one of the great names had a map showing them the way to go. Not one of the great European explorers discovered anything new. Somebody discovered the world before Europeans did.
Luthia belongs to a race found historically along the rim of the Indian Ocean. In East Africa, in the islands of South Asia, and in Australia and Melanesia. Was this then the face of a first American? Her reconstruction is confirmed by measurements Walter Nevis has taken of all his skulls.
The first reaction was not to believe in it. But as the results, you know, repeated so many times, and the result is exactly the same thing. They are very similar to nowadays Aborigines in Africa, and no similarity at all with Mongoloids in Asia or with American Indians. Very similar to nowadays Aborigines in Africa, and no similarity at all with Mongoloids in Asia or with American Indians. Very similar to nowadays Aborigines in Africa, and no similarity at all with Mongoloids in Asia or with American Indians. Very similar to nowadays Aborigines in Africa, and no similarity at all with Mongoloids in Asia or with American Indians.